And we are recording, this time for reals.
Hello!
Hello! This video comes from the future! This is... today we have gathered here to repeat a chat that we have already had, or recreate a discussion we have already had, and fill in for some lost footage.
Rebuild the data.
Yes. And the topic is...
Our assumptions
about how shit works in universe.
Our world building basics.
Yes. And it's gonna work like this. Nux is gonna read the points, and then I will interrupt him and yell and say, No, that's too detailed! No, yeah, basically Nux is gonna read the basic point and then we're gonna discuss it a little bit. So
let's just get straight into it.
Go.
Assumption number one. Within the time frame of a few centuries from now, the levels in spacefaring, material science, biotech and medicine are sufficiently advanced to initiate mega projects with the end goal of exoplanet colonization. And when I say a few centuries from now, I mean like now.
Yes, so this is the first assumption. Excuse me. The first assumption is the point where we link the future stories with our current world. And basically the assumption is that we are not dealing with alternate history. We are not dealing with any unknown technologies in our timeline or any of that. We are just assuming that after a while, from the world as it is now, these developments take place. And the list of the advancements, it's not an exhaustive list. It's just that we need... It's based on what we need to happen in the stories in the future. Like, we need medical technology to be sufficiently advanced to allow for humans being placed into cryosleep or suspended animation or whatever the fad world or fad technology of the day. So we need medical advancements for that. We need biology advancements and we need biotech and material advancements and also genetic research to enable building up and also storing for future use of artificial ecosystems. So basically the mentioning of all these sufficiently advanced technologies, this list could go on and on and on. So these are just examples.
Yeah.
All right, I think we can go on. Yeah?
I was just going to say, and it's because of all these advancements that they're now able to initiate these mega projects. It all ties in together.
Yes. So there are the advancements that the story will need for those mega projects to happen. So we might be missing something very obvious from the list. It can be added later, because without that particular idea, that thing could not possibly happen.
Yeah. Nice. Assumption number two. Within the habitable zone of Milky Way, we have discovered and researched a bundle of star systems with very life-friendly conditions. Author knowledge, the working nickname for this region is Goldilocks Cluster. It is entirely made up. The exact size and number of systems within the cluster or map space or explored region is not pinned down. The stories and speculation so far have observed approximately 70 star systems, but there is room for previously unobserved worlds / systems to be brought into life, or brought into stories.
So this is the outline of the sandbox where these stories that we are writing now will take place. Mm-hmm. So again, we are connecting our world and what hypothetical advancements might have happened in our world to the future world. And the idea is that we are not trying to tie this future space sandbox with any currently known exoplanets, because that real info can change, but made up info remains. So yes, all this is completely made up. And now I remembered one point from yesterday. The idea that there is one region where star systems and habitable worlds are abundant comes from, I think I called it Occam's hatchet one day. So basically, you need certain conditions to line up just right in order to have a habitable world. So if you have these habitable worlds dotted around different regions, different places all over the galaxy, you will have to have those conditions line up just right many times, which is more difficult. But let's say if you hypothetically have this one sort of sweet goopy region where it's basically, that's like you get my brain is sort of starting stuttering here, but basically the idea is that if you have this one place where a bundle of star systems are within the sandbox, where the conditions have aligned just right, it is actually requiring less assumptions. Like I don't know if it's technically correct, but it feels like it's easier to have those conditions aligned just right in this one area. So that's why our made up region has all these worlds within it, which the humans will set their eyes on and travel there.
And it's not like every single planet.
Yeah.
Or every single system, like, they're not all perfectly habitable
for human
life. Like, there are dead systems, there are, you know, really unappealing systems.
It is just a bountiful region with great density of good conditions.
Mm-hmm. And there's also the element that it hasn't all been discovered yet,
mm-hmm.
or it hasn't all been popular.
Research?
So if new authors come in and they want to add to the sandbox, it's not out of the question for them to do so.
Yes, this will be a point with later on assumptions. But basically, the idea is to set up these assumptions in such a way that some basic ideas are fixed, like cornerstones are fixed, but there is plenty of wiggle room built in to the sandbox, so to speak. Next.
So assumption 3, a wave of historical developments, including tech and spaceflight advancement, urgent need for more resources, competition, friction, and wars between countries, groups, factions on Earth, has led to the point where mega projects start happening. Several parties / interested groups / companies begin long-term work that leads to the development of terraformer ships, each capable of seeding a new human homeworld, optimizing atmosphere, building up biosphere, implanting ecosystems, kickstarting human colony. Until the terraforming and biosphere building phases are going on, the human colony inhabits the ship itself, i.e. each of these mega arcs is able to sustain an artificial ecosystem within. Author knowledge, the exact number of terraformer projects is not fixed. Some might be built in secret, some might fail and or consolidate with another project. When deciding on central builders, we're somewhat taking into account the current era space programs and countries and or corporations, a round working number of projects might be 5 to 10 for major builders and 20 to 40 for smaller and indie builders. Within the time frame of 20 to 50 years, the Terraformer projects are nearing completion. Some are being built at low Earth orbit, some elsewhere in the solar system. Author knowledge, not all projects are accounted for. Some arcs take longer to complete than others. Further in the timeline, there is also the assumption that not all the Terraformers reach their intended destination. All this means that the expedition numbers can fluctuate, as can timelines. So this is the point we sort of briefly touched on in the last one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this is the big assumption that there were these mega ships, mega projects, and they mm-hmm. worked. So
yeah.
So with all these steps in the timeline, a lot of shit can go wrong, but some of that shit must have worked since these stories are happening out there in the future.
Yep.
So basically we are sort of building backwards. We are generating the assumptions that are necessary for those stories to be able to happen. And instead of saying this country built this, that country built that, we're trying to shake things up a little bit. I don't think we have any particular stories that focus on who collaborates with whom, how, etc. But we are gonna seek some pointers from where on current Earth there are active space programs. So you might have one expedition that has ties to NASA. You might have an expedition that has ties to whatever the India space program was called, the exploring something something something. It was an acronym which I can't remember. Etc. 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 And behind the builders, behind the science, behind the preparations, behind the processes, there can be different interest groups. For example, you can have different smaller independent research groups come together and basically work together in the name of one expedition. And about their location, so one sub-assumption or assumption to build this assumption on is that space technology will have advanced to the level where you can construct things on the orbit. So the project, a ship so big, will be so huge as and would require so much lift that even if you ignore the environmental cost, even if you ignore the idea that you're gonna blast a whole big hole in the Earth's face on takeoff, even if you ignore all that, it would still be prohibitively impractically or prohibitively expensive to get such a big ass motherfucker off the ground. So the idea is that these ships are being built in space, and regular spaceships are going back and forth and transporting people and goods and all that. Also, briefly, when it comes to the preparations needed for setting up such a project and preparing such an expedition, we actually do have ideas about some aspects of biology and biotech and medicine and all that, but we're gonna make a separate topic about it because it's gonna need some preparation and homework and sorting out other notes and so on.
in the future, I think it's pretty fair to say that we'll be breaking down at least some of these assumptions mm-hmm. in future videos. So
yeah, unpack
that's
a lot.
Where we'll cover that. Yeah. Yes. Assumption number four. The Goldilocks cluster is far enough from Earth that reaching there by means of traditional propulsion would take immense time, more than our in-universe storyline covers. One major assumption for the Terraform Exodus is that these ships/fleets are harnessing new and or experimental and or extreme means to fit the from here to there process into no more than a few human generations. Different expeditions use different methods to achieve that, and results vary. Activating these extreme measures is delayed until the expedition has reached far enough from Earth's proximity via slow propulsion, which adds to the travel time. Each Terraformer expedition includes the main arc, plus a fleet of support vessels, scouting ships, etc. Fleets can vary. And each expedition addresses the flight time versus human lifetime issue somehow, including cryo technology, generational solutions, automation, combination and rotation of all of the above. Exact solutions vary from project to project. Author knowledge: the working nickname for this process is called the First Exodus.
Yes, so this is the big wave or big process that again takes us from our world to the new worlds.
Mm-hmm.
And once again, the big sub-assumption or the under-assumption for this one is that some of these things worked out. That even though a lot could go wrong, even though the projects were big, even though not everybody made it, even though some might still be on their way, the basic idea is that since there are stories happening in the future in those worlds populated by those people, some of it did work out. And when it comes to the experimental and or extreme technologies of travel, or extreme means of travel, what we mean here is there will be some inventive hand waves about experimental wormhole-ish kind of sort of thing. I would imagine that at least one of the expeditions would employ an Orion drive, because that's just something cool to have in universe. But the one employing the Orion drive would be one to travel a long time, because that is basically traditional propulsion on steroids. But one of the one point that actually leads to one of the next assumptions is that there will be new discoveries, new breakthroughs that allow humans to interact with space-time in ways that we currently do not know of. And some of those solutions, some of those discoveries will allow placement in time space that is currently unfamiliar to us. So in shorthand, think wormhole experiments, essentially quick travel, and yeah. And all of these instances come with risks. Not all of them work out. So again, let's say we have a number of terraformers built, then some of them fail, so the numbers diminish. We have a number of expeditions going out. Again, some of them fail. Again, the numbers diminish. until some will make it and start colonizing. So there's this uncertainty about numbers, which again gives us wiggle room when it comes to bringing in new stories. So let's say we have an expedition leading to a new homeworld which we know well, that we have told stories about, and we have another corner of the sandbox where there's a potential story for a potential homeworld, for a potential expedition from a potential interest group that we don't know so well, that a new author might very well start writing for. So again, there is this built-in wiggle room in the assumption tree, or in this layering.
Assumption number 5. After long interstellar travel time, the terraformer expeditions start reaching their designated star systems, locate their hand-picked exoplanet, land there. The time for that varies from expedition to expedition. 4 of the major expeditions would arrive within 40 to 400 years from launch. Some smaller indie colonists might catch up within a millennium. Not all expeditions that started off are accounted for. Some expeditions might have been keeping in touch sporadically during the journey.
This one pretty much speaks for itself, because
yeah.
I think the commentary that went together with this one is what we covered with the previous point, is that we are assuming that these things worked out, and we are assuming that they did find methods to travel in such a way that you get the fleet from here to there within a certain time frame, and that might come up later, but there is one note about the timeline. Oh, my video has frozen. Yours as well. I know. One point about the timeline is that even though we are throwing about some approximate numbers, what those numbers mean for humans can differ, because let's say very roughly speaking, if we throw out the broad stroke that somebody was on Earth, and then 2,000 years later we have a story in a new homeworld, it doesn't necessarily mean that the humans involved in that expedition went through 2,000 years worth of generations, because some of them might have been preserved in such a way that you're actually dealing with less generations. So again, it's about having wiggle room, and it's about being able to claim certain continuity when it comes to language and culture and knowledge and preservation of those. Okay, next one.
Assumption number 6. After the terraformer motherships have landed on their chosen exoplanet, it will take centuries for the terraforming and biosphere building processes to complete. Within that time, most of the expedition population keeps living and working. Ongoing research on the mothership, possibly setting up smaller contained outposts and settlements on the ground. This can also vary a lot between expeditions. A long time passes, and after the terraforming and colonization in the new homeworld has been successful, each new homeworld keeps developing culturally and advancing in technology. Author knowledge, the number of new primary homeworlds is not pinned down, but the current stories and speculations have mostly followed 4 major forces, Rewel, Yorth, Archaos, and Arabia, as well as some indie worlds, later rivals such as Rystar, Thanatos, Fargan, Khan, Trilasi, Kyrex, and Setin. In addition, there are certain implied primary homeworlds that exist in author knowledge but might not have explicitly entered the stage in-universe. Also, expeditions that are unaccounted for.
Yes, so the unaccounted for is a sort of running gag within this list. Like almost at every step, when we say somebody made this and achieved this, there is always the caveat that some participants were unaccounted for, which again gives the built-in wiggle room and gives the chance to insert new offers and new stories into the existing structure. So it's like Mendeleev's periodic table. You know the general number of rows. You have set up the rows and the columns based on specific parameters, and you even have those slots filled in with elements, but you also have gaps where you can guess that, yeah, there might be something there because those properties exist, but we don't know about it yet.
That's awesome. That's an
Yes.
awesome mechanism.
Yes.
Nicely done.
And since I'm unable to recreate the terraforming process commentary from yesterday, I think let's leave that one for its own topic, because the whole that's a whole topic unto itself. The ideas we have about biotech, again, neither of us is a scientist, but it's more like what technologies we need, because that's what's happening in the story, so we need the technologies to enable what's happening in the story. So that part, and biotech and ecological engineering and composite life forms and all that. This is a whole topic unto itself. So I think let's leave it at that today, and that is the story for another day. Indeed. And that's the point where the old footage will catch up. So enjoy that one.
Costume change.
Yep, let's return to yesterday. There. So, where was I? The assumption that shit worked. So yes, I understand that one kind of biggie is the colony continuity issue, the sort of free generation maintenance decay or whatever, for which I will say we shall assume that they figured it out. They figured out how to resolve this. Let's say again, solutions may vary, but let's say some expeditions, some colonists apply some sort of cultural or custom thing. Think Fremen in Dune. They maintain the water balance for generations and generations, because it's built into their culture. There's religious component to it, mythological component to it. I'm saying it's solvable, and even if I don't know the solution, we're gonna assume that the people who set up the expeditions figured it out.
I have nothing to add.
Yeah,
I wrapped that up
and
quite nicely.
yeah, and I would add that the whole biosphere build-up and the in-universe biology and ecosystems thing—that's a whole new topic on itself, which I intend to put together its own guide for one day. So maybe one day there will be a video about that. Carry on.
Do you want me to read the assumption and you read the quote?
Yep.
Okay. Assumption number 7. As the new human homeworlds grow and develop, a major breakthrough in physics happens, a theory that allows interacting with space-time in ways unknown to our current world. author knowledge. This is completely made up quantum hand wave that will be the basis for many in-universe technologies. This new theory and its spawn lead to three crucial branches of in-universe tech tree. Transit, which is essentially fast travel. Stasis, which is petrified moment, different from cryotechnology. And advanced nanotechnology that allows to meld and mend matter in many ways. Particle programming and quick heal solutions go under this. Edit, various gravity manipulations would also stem from related theories. An in-universe exposition moment on said theory takes place in virtual learning environment.
Yes, so I added the gravity manipulations later because I remembered that would also fall under this umbrella theory, which would spawn specific theories. But yes, the in-universe exposition comes from one of my own little story moments, and everything that you're about to hear is happening in what we call the Educator. It's basically a glorified VR or sensory immersion thingy, and one of the characters has been placed into the immersion environment, and has been tasked to learn exactly these topics, and she's been going through some experience already, and has posed some questions, and has traversed some quote-unquote places inside the virtual world. And now the penny drops. I think I understand. She felt rocked and watched the hairs on her arm stand up. The Girin Vanamangura threshold. The hypothetical barrier. She reached out again and gently touched the surface. Her arm intersected with the matter, and with some effort, she stepped through the stone. We needed to cross it. Learn to interact with the world, the forces, the pieces, on a deeper, more fundamental level. At first there were only lucky coincidences. Accidental harnessing, first smart matter formulae, minor biological repairs, augmentations. Until we learned more. And then we had the self-repairing alloys, we had stasis, transit, we flourished, we grew. And now we are learning to interact with this level even better. I think that's enough. I'm going to leave out the last sentence.
Okay. I'm going to continue reading the last little bit of this assumption, and then we can go back and review. Yep. The theories leading to this breakthrough existed earlier, and some of the related processes might have been used even during the first Exodus, but without fully understanding their background. Several homeworlds might be doing the related research at once, as it so often happens. One probably reaches the breaking point first.
So yes, this is one of our great hand waves.
Mm-hmm. Or one basic lie.
Well, not one basic lie, but when it comes to the future technology and future resolutions, what we try to do is to make it all stem from one assumption that there was such a breakthrough, there was some sort of new discovery, new understanding that allows, on one hand, well, so to speak, dip your toes into or literally put your dirty little hands into the quantum level and mess with that one, while also messing with some of the forces that we are right now unable to interact with, so that's where the gravity manipulation comes in, because every good, like, our goal is not to write hard sci-fi. Our goal is not to get things right, but when it comes to in-universe, in-story interactions, we are gonna try to address some issues a little bit above the pay grade of an average ray gun pulp novel.
Mm-hmm.
But instead of coming up with oh, they have a dark matter generator kind of solutions, we say yeah, they had this problem and they figured it out. We might not know the details, but we're going to assume that there was this based on this one major breakthrough, they were able to figure it out.
Mm-hmm.
So again, one of these sort of umbrella assumptions that spawns a whole lot of other scaffolding for in-universe technology and such. Anything to add?
No, just that. Yeah, this is one of the big things for me, in that this allows us to do things like transit and stuff like that. And
yeah,
that's important because it means we can avoid terms like faster than light and light years and, you know, all that sort of stuff.
Well, light year is a measure of distance, so it's still useful. I have no quarrel with light years. but
I tend to move away from stuff like that. I tend to move away from units of measurement in favor of just saying, oh, it's transit, you know, like it's
yeah. So transit is another one of those topics that would probably warrant its own video one day.
Yep.
But in a very abstract summary, I think the idea is that it's a solution that instead of describing traveling through space with increased speed, we are describing the interacting with space-time in an unknown way, which results in a containment field being converted from one space-time point to another, and I think it's more similar to Dune's folding space concept than faster than light concept. You would be from one point to another in shorter time span than it would take light to travel there, but you didn't travel with the light, did you? and with it comes the assumption that that the people inside that containment that gets folded into the other place, for them their sense of time during this process might differ from what people on the outside, or the outside observer and the inside observer disparity will be a thing, but it won't be a fixed down thing. It's more like, oh, once you completed transit, your clocks needed to be synced with the basic time space again. That sort of thing. And another idea is that this process is not instantaneous. So it is still gonna, for the people inside this containment, it's still some time is still gonna pass, as well as for those outside. And one other note, which is already quite detailed, my headcanon is that this process is more akin to maintaining a dial-up connection than it is to go from point A to B. So it's a computational when it comes to describing the in-world technology, it's a matter of computation, not propulsion.
Yeah. That succinctly puts it very nicely.
Yeah.
It's a computational thing, not thrusters and engines and all that sort of stuff. Yeah, cool. Next. Assumption 8. After the major breakthrough / quantum handwave, the new human homeworlds / primary homeworlds begin venturing outside their systems more and more, further colonizing their vicinity and exploring / mapping their slice of space more thoroughly. Some homeworlds seek out the other former expeditions. Contacts are established, technology is shared and advanced, alliances and rivalries happen. The usual.
Oh, that's it?
Yeah, that's assumption 8. This is the spreading out assumption.
Yeah, so this is where, again, built on the previous assumption that this and that expedition worked out, figured their shit out, we're able to form a new homeworld with what they had and colonize it, and now they have grown enough to venture outward.
Mm-hmm.
In combination of the big primary homeworlds and the smaller new homeworlds, more and more space within that initial bubble gets explored, and the humans start meeting up again. I remembered one assumption that we haven't mentioned in here is that the regard and knowledge of Earth can vary from expedition to expedition, or from homeworld to homeworld. Like, in the official historical knowledge, Earth is a thing. Like, they know where they originate from. They know the backstory, even if the details might get fuzzy. Whereas in the popular culture and in the everyday culture, some people would find it ludicrous that there was a single homeworld where everybody originated. It's like the we sort of consider it the flat earthers of the future. what are you saying? We have always been here. How can you say that we came from somewhere? So it's like, so these new homeworlds are literally a few thousand years old. And there are people who won't believe it.
Flat earthers. Now that's a video for another day. Assumption number 9. In the new human homeworlds and those colonized in a second wave of terraforming that originates from those primary homeworlds, there are many languages. As a means of simple shared communication between the homeworlds, however, a common second language or trade language is adopted. Standard Galactic, that borrows largely from international English. Author knowledge. Standard Galactic is being preserved and maintained as the common second language / trade language. Standard Galactic is to modern English as modern English is to Roman Latin. I love that.
that is one of the better sentences that I have ever written.
Yeah, this is cool.
Yeah, so yeah, again, brain fart. Implementing wise, in stories, or like when you read a story, when it's not specifically addressed, when it's not specifically brought up, when two characters are talking and there's no explicit mention about language struggle, you can just sort of assume that they understand each other without too much of a fuss. Whether it's because mm-hmm. they share a common language otherwise, or whether it's because they are using standard as the stepping stone, depends on the story. Sometimes it is pointed out, sometimes it's not. But it's basically, the idea is that we are aware and we shall address the idea that that there are many languages. It's just that sometimes the switch between languages is not entirely explicit,
mm-hmm.
But you can assume that it's there, As for the space English, yeah, it's a little bit of a cop out. It's a sort of it's something to make our life simpler, but again, let our hand waves be elegant. So the idea behind our in-universe standard is that we already do have the example of a common second language, and indeed, English is not my first language, yet I use it every day to talk with people for whom English is not the first language either, and we are using it as a common means of communication. And when I have to, let's say I need to translate or need to understand something between language that is too far from my own, often nowadays English is used as a stepping stone. So we're just projecting that process farther in. I also remembered another sort of corollary assumption. When it comes to the age of the homeworlds and age of the cultures, then the duration of human culture in a homeworld is oftentimes not as long as the duration of the terraforming. Let me elaborate. The idea is that because of the different means that different expeditions employ to not deal with the many living humans on a ship, meaning some of them are using cryotechnology, some of them are using some sort of suspended animation, whatever. The cultural what I'm trying to get at is that even though the timeline says 2,000 years have passed, the cultural continuity has to cover a smaller gap, because not everybody was awake all the time, to put it very simply. So that's why for me, the idea that when the new homeworld people start meeting up again, there is still memory and or sources for putting together this common second language. So basically the continuity has not been fully broken yet.
The only thing I would add is that when two characters in the book are speaking the same language, we present that as English.
Yeah,
That's one of the other probably major things that I'd mention. But I mean, that pretty much wraps it up. If two characters are talking to each other and they understand each other, we present that in English for the most part.
Yeah.
Assumption 10?
Yeah, so all the language and culture questions is again a bigger topic, which probably warrants its own video one day.
Yes. Assumption 10. By the time frame that most of our stories and speculations take place in, there is a well-established contact and standardized/compatible means of communication and info exchange between the accounted for human homeworlds. The primary homeworlders have explored and mapped their neighborhoods to the point that there is a common understanding of the G cluster's practical borders. There might be interesting stuff hidden around those borders, especially the unaccounted for stuff, but normal mundane travels don't venture there, and the space within the known cluster is vast enough to accommodate many systems, worlds, cultures, and stories.
Yeah, so this is basically the point where our stories begin.
This is now.
Yeah, so in universe, this is the starting point or the now. So we have an established practical border for the new human sandbox. The practical border meaning that on one side you might have empty interstellar void. On another you might have further systems that are not practical to colonize. On yet another you might have some sort of some sort of space wedgie. On yet another side you might have some other obstacles. So basically they have found the edges, not the physical edges of the bubble, but the edges from where exploring further would take too much effort at this point. And also the contacts between the homeworlds have been established. They do have established a common second language. They do have means of traveling in such a way that that a trip from system to system is no big deal anymore. So there are practicalities in communication and in movement and in exploration that have sort of defined this story sandbox.
Mm-hmm.
And within the sandbox, there are many things unaccounted for. You have under that pile there. You have the old toy truck that that little Timmy buried there 2 years ago. And it's not explicitly said that it's there, and nobody mentions it, but it's there. And when it comes to communication means, again, we are assuming and sometimes addressing various little technical means in universe, like simple technologies. Well, simple, as in not. Not necessarily overly future technologies, but more like technologies that you would expect to work in our time. So when it comes to translation between not so compatible languages, there we have thought of solutions that that would help in everyday situations.
I think in-universe communications is a video in and of itself as well.
Yeah, yes, again. So several, the farther we get with these assumptions, the more we step into the territory of, and this needs its own huge topic and such. But yes, this, what was it, 9, 10?
10, yeah, we're done.
Yeah,
the summary now.
Yeah, so these 10 points were the sort of base assumptions that we were able to distill down from all our notes and discussions and everything in between.
Mm-hmm. Would you like me to read the summary?
No, you don't have to, because the summary is more like a visual aid.
All right, cool.
So I don't think we need to read the summary. The summary is just a representation of the handwritten notes.
Mm. All right, cool. Well, I hope you have enjoyed following along with these. It's been a long one, but
yeah,
I think
it's
worth
getting dark here.
Yeah, and here everyone's turning their streetlights on. This has been sort of like the groundwork of the timeline, let's say, of how we got to the point we are now.
Yeah.
This, the very basic sort of outlines of how the stories that are now came to be. So
not even how the stories came to be, but what we know to be there in the foundation.
Yeah.
Of the current stories.
And it's important to have this stuff written down.
Yeah.
Because everybody's headcanon is different until it's until it's all agreed upon and written down on the same page. I don't have anything else to add. I think our next couple of videos are going to probably be going into some of this stuff a bit more in depth.
Yeah, I think we've covered pretty much all the important points today, and we've covered quite a bit of ground today. So yeah. Before the next patch of videos, there's probably going to be some homework and debates and such.
Yeah.
It's been
looking forward
a long
to
day.
It.
Yep.
All right then. Yeah, thank you very much for watching, guys, and I'll leave it up to you now, Lore.
Yeah. So, if all this has brought on some intrigue, check out chaosnova.co.uk. We have some sample stories there, and check out my channel and Nax's channel and the new ChaosNova writing corner channel for story reading videos, because some of this material is put to good use there, or more like some of the material there shows how these assumptions work in world. Yeah, I'm pretty tired now. I think we can wrap up.
All right. Cool. Thank you so much for watching. Take it easy, guys.
Bye.
Bye.